Hello guys, hello, 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 in the this season's meta snapshot, let's call it. It's a little bit later than usual because I kind of forgot about it, but I will do it quickly so you can, well, I guess you probably know what's in the meta, but if you want to see some new decks as well that I think are good, then you can stay and check. I will of course link all of them in the description below with some marks, as always, or as I try to. I have prepared 3 decks for each faction with 3 different leaders, so you have plenty things to choose from. Some are worse, some are better, but each of these deck can get you to pro rank, I believe, if this is your goal. Also, before we start and before I quickly describe each of the deck, I will quickly rant about the idea of the snapshot, let's call it, and so you can like stay with me for this part. But if you don't care about it, you can like skip in the description. You know, you will have the like the time stamp where you can just jump to decks, each of the deck. But yeah, if you like the video, please drop a like and subscribe because it helps a lot. And I will now start a little ramble or like rant about the idea of snapshot. So first of all, and I will keep this screen in my on my screen because it's a very important screen. What is snapshot? Snapshot is the way that a particular figure or set of figures gives an understanding of a situation at a particular time. What it basically means in terms of card game, it shows, if you call it meta snapshot, it's like a snapshot, like a take from meta and present to you. So what it should mean is basically, if I give you a snapshot, I should give you the decks that are present on meta and I should present them. That should be the definition of meta snapshot. What all of the teams and all of the websites and all of the clickbaits are trying to like are giving you is not really a meta snapshot. Keep it in mind. What everyone is doing is giving you basically a tier list and decks that they think are good. They put in text choices that they think are good. Is it a meta snapshot? Well, not really, because if you for example go to the like one of the like big teams metas decks, when they release the meta snapshot, like the day they release, you can see like, I don't know, Nilfgaard with Boneheart or like Shilard that no one plays on the meta, and poof, you have a meta snapshot from team A. But no, I'm not trying to say that it's team Aretuza, I just say it's team A, it can be team X, let's say. And you see the card in it, and you never encounter it. It's not really meta. It's not really snapshot from the meta. It's sometimes something that they invented and they thought it's good in the current meta. Is it meta snapshot? Not really. It's a meta tier list. Also, they are kind of creating the meta. They are not reporting to you what is in meta. They are basically creating meta. When they are creating the meta, when they are doing so, they can also like counter this meta. So if you want to play a very good deck, you should look at the meta snapshot, or more like a meta tier list, or like a good decks that good teams think are good with good cards. Then you can like sort of build a deck and counter it, and you might have a lot of success because they are creating the meta snapshot. They are not giving you a meta snapshot. They are basically, if there is a team X that will give you, that is very popular, and they are like they make public the tier list, as I call it, what they put, and then all of the players, all the people that like to net deck are playing this deck, well, it turns to be a meta snapshot. But before they produce it, when they release it, it's not really a meta snapshot. If I would like a day one make a meta snapshot of the current patch, like on the 1st of September, the meta snapshot would be probably Shield Wall, there was plenty of it, Symbiosis, Harmony, Frost, Force of Nature, and that would be basically a meta snapshot, Imprisonment, yeah. From the day one of the meta, of the patch, that was a meta snapshot, that was the meta of that day. People started to figure out what decks are good, what they are bad, and then they created the decks. Sometimes they created them in their own teams, and then they released something that they call meta snapshot, but it's not really a meta snapshot. So, okay, I'm done with this rant. I just wanted to describe you that every time you see a meta snapshot, it's not really a meta snapshot. It's basically a tier list, I would say it, of the decks that particular teams think are good. Speaking of, we are gonna go to my meta snapshot. Yeah, I'm just joking now, because I'm just gonna give you three decks for each faction that I think are decent and like can get you to pro rank if this is your goal. Are these decks like a meta defining? Some of them. Are they like super popular? Some of them. Are you gonna see them at the tournament in the Gwent Master? Maybe, some of them, not all of them. Remember that I have a lot of decks, and usually the meta is dominated by like 3 decks, 4 decks, and I'm trying to give you 18 decks, so keep this in mind. Okay, that's it for my rant. One other thing I want to add is that I didn't create all of these decks. I looked through the meta snapshots of all of the teams I could find. I did some personal choices of some cards. I tried to gather some data, some information, and I kind of give you a direction what are the good decks. Sometimes you will see like different card choices, some tech choices. I just want to give you like a general idea what to focus on. And yeah, again, some of these are not my ideas entirely. It's like the generated by all of the meta and the opinions of different people. Okay, so first we have monsters. For monsters, Overwhelming Hunger. It's pretty a common deck since release of Overwhelming Hunger. It's been there and here and there. And depending on the meta, sometimes it's better, sometimes it's worse. But it's always there, it's always okay. The problem is that it's very predictable, like everyone is everyone knows what to expect from this deck. And also, you play Hound that is not protected by anything in most of the cases, so Bomb Heaver just deleting a lot of points from you. So, you have Usual Suspect of a little bit of Thrive, a little bit of... This is also a Devotion deck, so you have like Conquerors that's gonna proc, you have Oberon that's gonna proc, a little bit of... A little bit of Frost just to Finn Winter Queen, and Usual Suspect. You'll use your leader most of the time on Miruna and twice Detlaf. Sometimes it's good to use it on Werkat, depends on the matchup, because if you want more AoE you can use on it, but in general you have some other consumes mechanic as well, so Overwhelming can be used quite fluently, like flexible. There are some different tech choices. You can take in Imperial Manticore if you feel like it, if you don't encounter a lot of Symbiosis or monsters. But I don't really... I'm not a big fan of Imperial Manticore, because yet again, if you play against Symbiosis that is quite popular, you will get from it like 7/7 most of the time, which is not amazing. And against monsters, they usually have some rats, for example, on the board, or some drones. So it's also like not that amazing. However, in some lower ranks, people completely don't play around it and completely ignore it, and they can just drop on the board like, I don't know, Herkia and just boost it with tactical advantage and just leave it on the board, and you can just Imperial Manticore and kill it, which is then a lot of value. So if you play on lower ranks, I suggest you to add this instead of Werkat or Ada Striga. And this is pretty simple deck. So that's it. Second deck from Monsters, I got this idea, I think from Miss Lady J, if I'm not mistaken, one of the popular streamer on Twitch. And she basically made, I don't know if this is the list she made, probably not. I was trying to build something from like my perspective, how I remembered it and how I think it should look like. But this is basically a tribe deck. It's very simple, especially if you are on like lower ranks. If you just started Gwent, if you are like rank 25, 30, whatever. It's a good starter deck if you can like, if you, I don't know, bought a lot of cakes and you got all of the monster cards. This is a pretty good deck for something like this and for climbing, because it doesn't require that much of thinking. I'm sorry if you feel offended, but it's like basically dropping the tribe. You play Larva, then Drowner, then Bruxa, then, I don't know, Beast, Wildhand, Bruiser, and you just stun tribe. You go tribe. You have this in round 1, and you do the same in round 3. That's it. You just tribe, and you can definitely win games. And of course, Force of Nature gives you another finisher in round 3 for more tribe. And deck number 3 is something different, so usually for like a deck 3 in most cases. I want to give you something more juicy, something more fun, something more unique. And here we have a Carapace deck that was created, if I'm not... Well, a lot of people claim that when I saw Carapace, this is the deck that I wanted to build day one. But I think I saw the earliest like a video or like commentary about it from Freddy Babes, if you know the guy, probably you know. And it was also popularized recently by Magpie, who won actually top 16 qualifiers to Open with this, with a very similar or exactly this deck. Why? Because Skellige is quite powerful. And these decks absolutely wrecks Skellige. These decks is amazing at Skellige because they can deal with big units. Okay, in most of the cases, sometimes they can Morgvar, but it's rare and it's also not killing your unit, which is important here. And sometimes they play Tirgivi, which you can answer with Consume, for example. So this deck is juicy, it's annoying to play against, and it's amazing against Skellige. The plan, you abuse the card advantage with Ciri, you destroy everything your opponent play with Kel'Thulis, and you just chill. You just kill everything and get card advantage. It's very good deck. But it's not that easy to play, I think, but maybe... I didn't have a chance to play it much, so... I think it's not that hard, come on, it's quite... But for a new player it might be a little bit awkward, so we need to be careful. But it wrecks Skellige. Second faction is Northern Realm, and well, if you are a visitor of Reddit, if you like Reddit, then you know that this leader is OP. To be fair, it's not OP. I don't think it's like OP, but it's a very good deck. And it's definitely meta-defining. It's the deck that you, if you cannot answer some stuff, if you cannot play around some other stuff, you just lose. And why? Because shield mechanic is very powerful with a duel mechanic, basically. That's it. There are some versions of this deck. I think I like this one the most. You can play around it a little bit. You can play, for example, instead Falibor, you can play even Philippa, you can play War Elephant, you can also play Seldkirk, for example, because he's also... I think that Seldkirk is a little bit like win more cards. I think you don't really need him, because you're gonna win with other cards. Yeah, well, there we go. Seldkirk. You can add Seldkirk. But it's a little bit of win more card, and if you want to play Seldkirk, you probably need to play a ladder as well, because sometimes opponents can move your units, so it's a little bit more awkward. And you usually want to stack your cards in a range row, because of Dawnmir and Visigotha work together well. This is good deck because it's flexible. You can go for like a tall removals, and you can go for greedy points from Visigotha and Anna. You have here also Dunbanners to thin a little bit, because you have some boosts, so you can get rid of them with like Radovitz Royal Guard, Kerak Marine. And also Trident Infantry is great in general with all your boosts. And Kerak Frigate is just carrying the faction, like usually. This card is this deck is very, very powerful. There are a few versions of it, remember. But it's not unbeatable. It's not Skellige like one man off ago. It's really not. So if you are bored of Shield Wall, but you like the deck in general, you can play also Uprising. And this deck is basically Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V from the Shield Wall deck. Because, well, it just uses the same powerful cards. That's a really problem of Northrend. It's not about the leader that much, however they just help the good cards. But there are some very good cards that it's hard to just skip, like Anesis, like Baron, Queen Adalia, Amphibious Assault, obviously, John Natalis, because it's like a package. These cards are just super powerful, and if you add them to any leader, they will just work. You can play Royal Inspiration, you can play Stockpile even, because I actually had a lot of fun and success with Stockpile this season, because some of these cards are just super powerful. So if you feel like you are done with Shield Wall and you want something different, then you can also try Uprising. It changes some cards a little bit, but it's quite similar. And for a juicy deck, I have my own creation of Siege Pincer Maneuver with Portal. It's super fun deck, I really like it. And it can definitely win games. I actually had a lot of success on stream with it. I even won with some Skelligant with some Shield Wall. So yeah, it can definitely work. The one thing you want to change is probably Odrin, and I'm not sure about Trollololo. These two cards you feel free to change. However, they just... Okay, Trollololo played usually for like 11, 12 points, something like this. So it's okay, but Odrin is usually like 9. So 9 for 7 is not amazing. So you can definitely change it. But other cards work great. You can swap things around. You don't need Folded Sprite. You don't need Philippa. You can change it, for example, to Falibor. And other cards are just Siege Engines, basically, or Warfare cards, because it's a resupply deck. And four provision cards you can't really change, but remember to play it on the range row, the portal, because you want to, just in case you get Redanian Knight, you want it on the range row immediately. Also, that's why they are free, so you never brick. And if you have last one in your deck, you can use it. You can summon it with Amphibious Assault, because, for example, Amphibious Assault of Kedwin on Kedwinian Knight is 12 points. And if you just finish a game with 12 points, it's not bad. It's basically like an Ozreal, pretty much. So it's a good finisher. And because you have all of the removal from like all the siege engines and from the siege. You can basically win games. And Pincer Maneuver helps you like not get the awkward cards. Usually you don't use it on Siege, but you use it on some machines. Sometimes you want to like, for example, get Philippa from your deck and put back Kerak Frigate to summon it with Amphibious Assault. That happened to me a few times. It's fun deck. Definitely can get you to Pro Rank, but you won't see it in tournaments because... Well, if you know what is coming, you can prepare for it. Next faction for is Squirtle, for sure not a big surprise for you. Symbiosis is first deck and I think it's pretty powerful. It got me to from rank 3 to 1 this season, I think, during the like first weeks. It's very powerful. It has a finisher of Gord. It has a lot of removal with like Rebuke, Circle of Life, Heatwave. And it can create points with Elias, with Novi Guardian Justice. It just do like a little bit of everything. You have some win condition with Hamdryad if your opponent is not playing any toll removal. You have some win condition with like a quick Gord. I'm sure you have seen plenty of this deck on ladder. It's good. It's actually fun to play as well. So if you didn't have a chance, you should try it. Another deck, a little bit similar in what they are playing, because it's also all about removal and getting rid of your opponent cards, is Precision Strike with Shiru. If the meta have like a very similar number of cards, like cards with the same power, Shiru is just great. And Some of the current decks do this, like not greedy NR. Some Skellige likes to line up the same power, for example. Some monster like to arrange the same power. So Shiru can work. Shiru can do some magic. And I have chosen the version with like a Synthesis because I like it. It makes the opponent like turn 3 very awkward, and it's quite a little bit of control-y meta. So if you can have like immune points, I just like it. And of course usual suspects, so 3 rebuke, 5th like nature forest protector. This is pretty standard deck, nothing fancy. It's a devotion version. You can also try non-devotion version. For example, you can play instead of Synthesis, you can play Karate Heatwave. You can add Bomb Heaver if you encounter with a lot of scenarios. And that's pretty much it. And for a juicy deck, I actually have a deck from my team, from Team Bandit Gang. There is a very cool article that I'm gonna link in the description below about this deck. And this is Redaya, a little bit of harmony deck with scenario. So like an elf deck, and it's very powerful. It's pretty cool. It's pretty fun to play. It has also a poison, so it does a little bit of everything. If you want to read more about it, I will link an article in the description below next to this deck. So then you can learn more about it. But it's pretty fun and pretty good. Next faction we have Skellige, and I think Skellige is still the most powerful faction just because of the same cards. The warrior cards are just nuts. And as you can see here, I wrote SK123. Why? Because I think this deck is like the best three decks. And what I mean by it, you can look at these decks, you can just put most of the warriors from the new expansion, and basically you have the deck. You just type in warrior and you play these cards and you have your deck. Done. It's amazing. And why it's 1-2-3? Because you can go here, you can change ability, you can pick Blaze of Glory, you can play Patrick Elder Fury, and without much of the changes you have 3 decks. You don't like Ravage of the Sea, you just put Blaze of the Glory, use pretty much the same deck. Done. You prefer to play Arnulf? Change like few cards, like a Jenga or whatever his name is. You have the deck. The core is the same. The core, like 15, 20 cards. Like, I get it's like 20 cards. All of these three leaders will use the same 20 cards. That's why it's 1-2-3. I didn't want to like build each deck because it's really pretty same. It's a little bit like Northrend Realm when you can play the good cards, but it's exactly the same archetype. You just play all of your warrior cards and you will have a good result. Turns out the new Greysword is still good, and I like the addition of Hjalmar because you have removal 10 in the deck. You can also add Totem, for example, to the deck. If you're playing Arnulf, you can play the guy that boosts and the guy that deals damage by the number, like twice the number of damage units, and that's it. This is the same deck in 3 different leaders. That's why for other decks I have more juicy stuff, and they are a little bit worse, because when, as I told you, I'm preparing 3 decks for each faction, so other decks for other leaders would be much worse. So this is like a 4th leader I would use if I would rank the deck. So it's a little bit worse, but it's an Arsene Ritual, but no Lippi. I'm not a fan, big fan of Lippi, because this is boring. You always play the same and you don't care what your opponent is doing. So this is my version with like self damage. You have Artis, who is a very good boy. You have Arnwald, who is actually not that bad, because you will have like cards with like 2 power, 1 power damaged. And then he can be like 9, 10. It's pretty okay. So I like him. And you have a Becker Dark Mirror that works great with cards like Olaf or cards like Champion of Svalblad when Wildcard is transformed, and also it can be used as a toll removal for Hamdryad, for like Gord, etc. So it's quite good. There is also like a package of Servheim from Svalbard Priest that can win you games with alongside Draco Turtle, for example, and usual suspect as well, Ceres, that fins your deck. I like this deck. It's super fun to play. It's maybe not very competitive, but it's fun to play. And the last deck, it's a little bit similar. It's an Alchemy deck with Gedinef. So the plan is, as usual with this deck, is to fin with Chrome Messenger in round one, stall your game with some more beasts and with like Axel and your priest. And then in round 3 you want to win with your scenario, so a very short round 3 is the best. Like the dream you want to have is to play Gedinef, then play Ermion into Resurrect a Bronze Priest so you can finish the scenario immediately. Then this is basically the dream scenario. And can this deck work? Yeah, it can. It's a surprise that no one expects, but the main problem of this deck and this leader ability is that this heal is completely has no synergy with the leader. I really don't get it. Like every time you play the Alchemy, you boost a lot of, you spawn a lot of, you boost them, you spawn. You don't really damage anything. So why there is like a heal here? Like, you will not benefit from heal. In some fringe situations when you don't draw Armor Drakkar, you don't draw Draco Turtle, you don't draw Covenant of Steel, or you don't draw Yuta, or I don't know, then maybe it will somehow give you value from heal, but I don't get this passive. But at least another Mardrum is nice point on Draco Turtle on like on any other cards with armor, and this is fun. Getting it is always fun. And now we are going to factions that are not quite good, or maybe they don't really have a visible decks in the current meta. First we have Nilfgaard, and I actually this season got to pro rank with Nilfgaard, and it from rank to 1 to rank 0 I used two decks, and I'm gonna show you these two decks. First one is my favorite, I really love it. It's a Hyper Fin Tactical Decision. I know that this is my creation, that this is the deck I made, and I know that some of the teams have it in their snapshots. Yet again, there is like no one is playing this at the moment, and they claim it's a snapshot of meta. See what I meant in my intro. Anyway, I've seen a lot of Imperial Golem, and I really, really, really don't get it, because the point of your leader is to like really set everything that you always will target Tibur. So you really don't need Imperial Golem as well. I really don't think so. This deck fins so much that you won't get another unit in your deck in like 90% of the cases, and if you like get it, it's like not the end of the world. You should still win if everything is going according to plan, and so basically means that your opponent cannot answer your big units or can bleed you. I like Dogos because Dogos will pretty much always proc. In current Gwent, everything has some sort of status. Remember that you can trigger this from Vitality of your opponent, from Shields, from Doomed Tag, from Veil on your opponent. So there is really not that many scenarios when your opponent is not playing Vitality, Shield, Doomed, Veil, or anything like this. It's really, really rare. If you really encounter something like this, that people that will just play vanilla units against you, you can add Collar instead of Magic Lamp, but I really don't think it's that necessary. But if you don't feel like it, you feel like it's awkward, then you can add it. Remember one thing, that now Imperial Brigade needs a soldier on the board. So you cannot just slam Artorius Vigo and be happy and summon samą Imperia Brigade. You can't do it anymore. You have to first have Menno or Vendal Elite on the board. So keep that in mind. Deck number two that actually got me to pro rank is Imprisonment Masquerade Ball. Yeah, that's the problem. Masquerade Ball is so good card that you basically, if you don't make a deck around it for Nilfgaard, then why you were playing Nilfgaard? But this is a fun version. I made like a 3 or 4 versions of this deck. So this one I like the most, but I'm not saying this is the best one. And like if some pro player will see it, they will laugh of it, obviously. But it's just fun for me. I don't have Defender, which you can add if you feel like it, instead of one of these cards. But I really like that Kehir can sometimes win you the game. Just you drop it and you just win a game. It sometimes happens. And I do think Vivienne is not bad at the moment in the current meta, because she always finds the value. And if you can't get your Masquerade Ball twice, which is sometimes a possibility for this deck, because it's not that consistent, because it doesn't run like on Aeromancy and Mata, etc. You can play a Sire for Roach for a nice 9-point play, and also you can Vivienne your Roach. Because Vincent, or as I call him, Lalo, he got hit with the Nerf Hammer a little bit, you can also play Vivienne on Vincent for nice 7 points, so 10 for 9 is not bad. And also she's an aristocrat, so she can proc your Masquerade Ball as well. As you can see, it's not a devotion deck, so keep in mind that Usurper is not an aristocrat, because he's aristocrat only in the last evolution, let's call it. You have also an instant removal with Imprisonment and Vanhammer. I really like it. You can like remove anything you want instantly. And other cards are pretty much standard, some Soldier package and some Spite package for like Roderick and Usurper boys. And that's it. It's fun to play as well, if you like playing Masquerade Ball, of course. And if you hate your opponent, you can play Lockdown. This is the deck I took from one of the... This is interesting. This is wrong, by the way. Oops. This is the deck I took from one of the meta snapshots from one of the team. I really like addition of Leo. It's almost always some points, and because now there are some of the cheesy Keltulis decks with series, and at least in the start of the season, people were experimenting with Siri Dash. Leo can actually kill. Like, remember that this has like destroy an enemy Witcher as well, and Siri is a Witcher, so that's like a bonus that can sometimes be handy. And other than this, this is like a ball control deck. It's like, I'm sure you've seen this one. It's just like I hate you deck. And if you want to annoy your opponents, go ahead. And for Hidden Cash, I had some problems because... not for Hidden Cash, for Syndicate I had some problems because... well, there are not many decks that are present on meta apart from Hidden Cash, which is like always good. If you want to give it a go, this is like my take on it. There are like different version. So there are like different version of Hidden Cash. This is my version. You don't have to run Binsey. Kurt is like a nice addition I recently added, and I think it's fun, but you can add, for example, the guy that gives you coins every turn from on the melee row. I really love Litwin von Hurst. He can be like a self-used Kerak Frigate if your opponent can answer it. And one Kiki Warrior is a fun addition to get 3 points every turn from your Flying Redanian. Of course, you want to win your game with Passiflora. And there is not much interesting more about this deck, because since Hidden Cash release, you basically have seen this deck several times, I'm pretty sure. Can this win games? Yeah. It has some poison for some big units. It has Passiflora, which is good if your opponent can answer it. Yeah, definitely you can win the games with it. The other deck is Congregate Swarm deck. There is also a few versions about it with it. I actually like this one, but there are some bronzes you can swap around. There are even some golds that you can swap around. I really don't like. Okay, like in previous deck, in Hidden Cash deck, I told you that I love this guy that spawns cards every time if there is like Horde 2. In this, it has Horde 4 and it needs to like to constantly give you cards, and I really don't like him. Like in this deck, I don't like holding coins in the swarm deck, and you swarm anyway a lot, so I don't think you need that card to just create more cards. But you can play it. I like Horsom Senior because you play some of the crime cards, so this is like another win condition, and I like when I have more than one win condition. And there is like one debatable card that no one likes, but I really like it, Damnation. I like it because Skellige spawn Harpies and Skoyetel spawns a lot of these small treants, so Damnation can find a lot of value. For example, if you have Fallen Knight and you use Damnation, you will get bonus points because it's a crime, you will get bonus points because it will spawn some units. So in general, it's at least like 10 points card for 8. It's not that amazing and it's conditional, but I like it. I just like this card in general. So you can cut it, but I like it. I also like Sacred Flame because now it's sort of like better Blood, better Bone Talisman. It's really good in a Swarm deck. This is the Devotion deck, but you also can make this a version without Devotion, with Trees. You can play it with also with Gord if you want to go for another approach. But it's also fun to play, so you should give it a try. Remember, like with Horsom Senior, you can spawn 3 charges of this and instantly transform both to Cataplexies. And the last deck, it was actually quite tough to find a good deck for Syndicate, like the third deck. I know that Freddy, when I was browsing like his ideas, I know that he made one funny deck with the new leader ability. I tried to make it with Collusion, I didn't really like it. You can try off the books with Bounty, but this season I tested a little bit Blood Money with Bounty. And it's worked quite well. I tried the poison version, but I think like a damage version will be better, much better. So what I mean by damage version is just you have this Morillus here, you have Horsom Freak Show in this deck, and it synergizes better with Bounty. I can sometimes miss like one bounty. So I added Witch Hunter from my previous deck, but I still kept a little bit of poison from Fistek Trafficker if you really want to. But they are mostly here for as a coin generator because of Flying Redania. But you can definitely use it offensively. You can also try to make it non-devotion deck with Maral and add a little bit of poison or Karate Heatwave or something like this. But this deck can definitely work. But it might be the worst, it's probably the worst one from Syndicate, and it's one might be one of the lowest from all of the decks as well, because it's not that impressive. People run a lot of Veil as well, so it's actually hard to play. I can't play this, I'm moron if it comes to Syndicate, and Bounty is sometimes hard to play. So that's it for my meta tier list, let's call it this time, but I'm gonna still debate you in the title with meta snapshot. I hope you like it. If you liked it, please drop a like drop a subscribe as well. It helps me a lot. I appreciate all of your views as well. I hope you like it. I will come back next season with another snapshot. Okay, it won't be a snapshot watch my rant in the start, you know what I mean. And anyway, thank you very much for coming. I will see you in the next video, probably tomorrow. So thank you very much, guys. See you next time.